chapter. Now Jesus and his disciples went out to the towns of Caesarea Philippi, and on the road he asked his disciples, saying to them, "Who do men say that I am?" And they answered, "John the Baptist, Elijah, some say one of the prophets." He said to them, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered and said to him, "You are the Christ." Then he charged them that they should tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He spoke this word openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when he had turned around and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're not mindful of the things of God, but of the things of men." And when he had called all the people to him, with his disciples also, he said to them, "Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? And what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Therefore, whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father and with the holy angels."
We will continue with our conversation with Johnny Cash right after this. John, I know you have a rather illustrious son-in-law who's a good friend and married to Roseanne. You like Rodney Crowell a lot, don't you?
Yeah, I do. You know what I like about Rodney Crowell? One big thing I like about him, he says exactly what he thinks. I mean, there is a man in whom there is no guile. You know? Rodney's he's not covering up anything. He's not hiding anything. When he talks to me, he's not, and when I've seen him do interviews, he doesn't. I mean, he's open and honest, and you know right away where you stand with Rodney. I've always known that, and I've known Rodney before I knew Rodney before he married Roseanne, and I was crazy and taking my pills, and Rodney was trying to help produce an album on me, and he bore with me night after night after night in California when I was doing that album, but still, he finally told me what he thought, and it really helped me, you know.
What did he tell you?
He told me I needed to straighten up and come to the studio without taking my pills, and we'd do a better job. He said, "It's that simple. Just don't take them, and you'll sing better." He was so right, and I knew it too, but I resented it, and I told him so. I told him it wasn't any of his business. He said, "Yeah, it is too, or I wouldn't be here because I care." You know, and when somebody says, "I'm here because I care," and you know they got no other reason to be there, you believe it. But aside from his talent and these awards, which he's...
So did this make, once you got through all of this, did this make recording with him a lot easier once you understood each other?
Yeah, we did another album that he produced. The album I did with Jerry Lee and Carl in Europe, you know, the live album. But we still had, we still squared off in the studio a couple of times. So then I started thinking, well, this Rodney Crowell is serious. You know, he can see right through me. When I'm bad, he knows I'm bad. And when I'm doing all right, he likes that. So then I straightened up and started really getting into the stuff with Rodney. And I hadn't been fortunate enough to work with him in a studio in the last 6 years, but I hope to sometime.
When he married Roseanne, did he talk to you about it first?
Well, it wasn't the kind of thing where he comes and says, "I'd like your daughter's hand." It's Roseanne had already told me, And then when I saw him, they were together. And he said, I'm going to marry her, you know. And he looked me right in the eye and I said, good.
John, the book, Man in Black, is copyrighted. This is it. It's copyrighted 1975.
Mm-hmm.
That was almost 15 years ago. You think there will ever be a sequel to this book?
I thought I'd told it all. Maybe so.
The last 15 years.
I've got two or three offers to do that very thing if I ever feel like writing that much about me again. It's a very painful thing to do.
Why?
Well, life's full of pain. And I'd say the most of the things about me that's made the news have, in the last 15 years have been fairly painful things. A lot of them have, anyway. And I don't care to write about drugs. I don't care to write about other troubles I've had or the other...
But you did so in this book.
Yeah, I know. I thought I was cleaning the slate there, but then life continues after the book is published. And more has happened to me since that book was published than before, all put together. I might write it sometime, but a different angle than Man in Black. I don't think I would do a kind of a self-unfoldment kind of a thing like I did in that book. To me, I'm not all that interesting. I don't want to, Ralph.
Okay. I know you have since written a book called Man in White, which is about the Apostle Paul.
Mm-hmm.
Your religion means a great deal to you, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, now, the Apostle Paul inspires me. There's a man who set out to conquer the world in the name of Jesus Christ and did it. Took the sect of the Nazarene, the Christians, to the whole Gentile world. And he was, to begin with, he was a man of the law, a very devout Orthodox Jew, and very zealous for the law, as it says, and so much to the point that he saw the sect of the religion of Jesus Christ as a vile sect of the Jews that desecrated Judaism, and he set out to destroy it. On the way to Damascus, after he had just about wiped the church out in Jerusalem, had gone undercover, he had a startling vision on the road to Damascus where Jesus Christ appeared to him in his glorified form, so much that it blinded him with the light and told him that he had been called to be the chief apostle. And he took that calling very seriously and set out to tell the world about it, which he did over and over. And I admire the man. You know, I had a couple of little Damascus Road experiences in my life. You know, not like he did. I never have seen the Lord or heard the voice, but like he did. But I had a turnaround a few times, and I can relate to him. And it's because he inspired me so that I wanted to write about him and study about him and read about him, which I did for years before I wrote Man in White.
Can you tell us about your road to Damascus?
Well, I didn't have an experience that lasted 2 minutes like he did that turned my whole life around. It took me days and weeks and years to turn my life around, and I'm still from time to time have to go back and turn it back around a little bit more because it keeps slipping back to the old ways. Not like Paul. He never did revert to his old ways. But my nature is so carnal, I guess I kind of, from time to time, try to revert to the old ways, and it's death and destruction, and I can't do it. So I have my little Damascus Road experiences every time I'm spiritually strong enough to do it. And writing the Man in White was one of them.
John, in all of this, I gather that one of the most difficult people you have to deal with is Johnny Cash.
Oh, he is the toughest one. He is the meanest one. He's the hardest one of all. If I could handle myself as well as I handle most everybody else, I'd be fine.
Going back to to the Sundays for a moment. When you went to Sam Phillips to record, you presented yourself as a, according to your book, as a gospel singer. Why did you do that?
I had written two songs in the Air Force that I thought were good. One of them was Folsom Prison Blues, and one was a talk, sing thing, gospel thing called Belshazzar, which I thought was the best of the two. And so it was on that premise that I called Sam Phillips. I had heard Elvis's records, you know, and I wanted him to know that that's not what I was into right at that time, that I really like gospel music more than anything else, because I happened to have that song I'd written that I believed in. And he turned me down. So then I called back a couple of weeks later and told him I was a country singer. And I was turned down again, but I kept calling him until he did listen.
What did you want to be?
I just wanted to sing. I just wanted to be on record, to make records.
What if he had accepted you as a gospel singer? Do you think you would have taken up a career in gospel music?
Probably not. I think I would have gone ahead and done the other things too. But I would have recorded gospel if he would let me, yeah.
What's your favorite record? Your favorite record by Johnny Cash?
My favorite record of mine?
Is it a hit or is it something obscure?
It's probably something obscure like You Wild Colorado, a song I wrote about the river, or one I wrote called Apache Tears. I don't know what my favorite song of mine might be. The one I like to perform most is I Still Miss Someone.
Why is that?
I don't know. I think it's a good country song. It's got a lot of heart.
You've had a magnificent career. What would you say are the top four or five Johnny Cash songs? The songs that people still react to when you sing on stage?
Ring of Fire, Folsom Prison Blues, Sunday Morning Coming Down, Orange Blossom Special, Boy Named Sue, I Still Miss Someone.
John, tell me about I Walk the Line.
I Walk the Line is a song I wrote one night in Gladewater, Texas, and I'd had the melody and those chord changes in my mind since I was in the Air Force. And I was talking to Carl Perkins, and I said, I got this idea for a song called Because You're Mine. And I started singing it. And then he said, I Walk the Line would probably be a better title. So I called it I Walk the Line. I wrote it that night in Gladewater, Texas. But I'd had an old tape recorder when I was in the Air Force, and somebody had sat down with a guitar and turned on my tape recorder and run these chord changes. And then when I played that back, it went to all those strange chord changes, you know, like I made on the record. I never could get it out of my mind, so that's the arrangement I used on the record. But I wrote the song in Gladewater, Texas.
What does the term I Walk the Line mean to you?
It means I'm staying true to you, baby, because I love you.
John, you're an interesting man.
Thank you.
And a good friend. And
thank you very much, Ralph.
I appreciate your sitting here and sharing your viewpoints and in some cases, bearing your soul to these cameras. And
yeah, my lawyers keep telling me don't do that. You know, it'll get me in trouble, but I can't help it.
I've enjoyed
it. By the way, this is apple juice, folks. It's not beer.
I've enjoyed this very much. Thank you.
Me too. Thanks.
Thank you, John.
I never thought I'd tell about that operation and what happened to me. I never thought I'd tell that.
About the light?
Yeah. That's something that take a whole chapter to describe if I wrote about it, you know.
Well, you wonder why I always dress in black, why you never see bright colors.